Jordan. How are you?
Nice to see you this morning.
See, Rick's quite a bit nice with that suit, wasn't he?
Oh, Jimmy.
Hey.
Merry Christmas.
Good to
see you.
Morning, Jimmy.
Hey, Dale.
Hi, Dale.
How are you, Chris?
Merry Christmas.
Hey, Jim, how are you?
Not too much, boy. 1:30 we got out of Joe Chris.
Oh, don't worry, Jim. How are you?
I like that thing.
Well, since yesterday, you heard all that, and I go repeat and plow ground already plowed. But I tell you, we need to be sure that we've been able to tell Tip now in the world that we've got more than 50 votes, and we've got 50 for the bill itself. But we feel that there's been maybe some flaking off, and I'd like to appeal to all of you again to go with us on this rule and this bill. And as I said yesterday, I know it's a situation none of us have ever been in which I would be asking someone to vote for something that I've promised I will veto if it comes out the way it is. But I do believe that this is the best way for us to have a chance of getting a general tax reform. And I think it gives us a chance to get back on the high ground and take away this false image they've got that we were somehow letting them down.
Secretary, how are you? Bill Emerson, how are you?
Hello, Ron.
Good to see you, sir.
Well, shall I repeat everything I said yesterday?
No.
Well, no, but I'll tell you, we were able to call and tip and tell him last night that we had 50 votes on both the bill and the rule, but there seems to be some erosion, and we need to be safer than that. We need more, and I'm here to appeal for some support first on the rule, and then be on the bill itself. But know that we've got more and or got enough votes after our call.
Mr. President, you said yesterday you wouldn't sign this bill as it now stands. And I understand the process argument, but we've always got ultimately the opportunity to vote against the conference report. But still, we have to go back and live with our constituents in the meantime. And I have to tell you that a very strong advocate against this bill was your former chairman in Missouri, John Powell, over the timber issue. John called me the other day after I voted against the rule and said it was the best doggone vote I'd cast since I've been here. And the timber's a terribly important district. It's a $2 billion industry in Missouri. And mining, 90% of the lead that's produced in the United States is produced in my district. They're already hit now with the Superfund. And with this on top of it, the lead industry's gonna close down. That's jobs in my district.
Well, on the timber thing, I can tell you that we've already talked to Packwood on the Senate side, and of course, as you can imagine, that's of interest to him too, and said this has to be changed in the Senate bill that we can make this. If we get this through the House, that must be changed in the Senate version. As his committee, of course, that's
it.
Hello, Mr. President. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
I'm trying to
officer present, you get to sit up there and throw.
We have a vote on the journal.
Why they vote now?
I won't hurt you.
Reagan, how are you?
Bill Schmidt.
Steve Gunderson. Hi, Jim. Steve Gunderson.
How are you?
Jim, how are you?
Fine, Bill, how are you?
Good to see you, Jim.
Good to see you, sir.
And Darren.
Morning, Bill.
Well, now, let me see, I'm going to repeat everything I said. No, but I'll tell you, I was able to call Tip last night and tell him that they have 50, and both want to be providing with a list for the bill and for the voting passage. But there's evidently been some erosion. We'd feel a lot safer if we had more than the 50 we were talking about, the bare 50, and both for the rule and for the final passage. And I can't add to anything that I said yesterday, but I know it's a queer situation. I'm asking for votes on something that I promised on veto if it goes down in that same way. But it is to get into that process, and then my feeling is that in a conference, the Senate version, there couldn't be any just feet in concrete on the other side for the Democratic bill if that's the one that's passed, because our conferees would be able to say that bill will be vetoed if it comes out that way, which I think should lead to some negotiations and an improvement that we could all live with.
Well, it's the first time in all the years I've been in Congress, Mr. President, that we have to do this, but I came down after listening to you yesterday convinced it was the only way to keep the process going. And I particularly appreciated the fact that you outlined the areas that you thought ought to be changed and were willing to put it in the letter. And I'll tell you, what you've done for this country, I'm with you all the way.
Thank you very much.
I'm not kidding you. I really believe that the people will understand, and if we don't get this cleaned up in the Senate, I probably will vote against it when it comes back. I'm willing to give it a chance.
I think the problem some of us have, Mr. President, is good.
I think he does.
I Yes, it is, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's a great pleasure.
On the hill, the chief veto, beside the back of the hill, not your proposal.
I think this is a night off.
Yeah.
It's a night off.
How about the pencil, Bill? Senator Thurmond said you got bad advice on that.
I haven't had any advice. This is a night off.
Did you like the show?
Can we have your review of the show, Mr. President?
It was a very wonderful and enjoyable evening, thanks to all of these wonderful people here.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's better than the last one. Oh, thank you. Yes, before that.
Thank you so much.
It has been through the budget review bullet and now on appeal to you. It is the Department of Defense, obviously, and at the conclusion, after you've heard both of this, we will give you a decision memo to make your decision sometime after this meeting. So with that cap, we will proceed.
Well, Mr. President, you're never supposed to open with an apology, but I'm sorry to be in here seeking more money. I used to sit where Jim Miller sits and always reject these things automatically, but there are 2 points that I think are very important. One is...
Normalcy. Okay, I'll reply.
Well, might as well get out of there.
It's not all right. The President, we know that this is one of your favorite subjects. And it evokes scintillating discussion, other things to mind. But Jim Baker was not able to be here today. He's tied up with something called tax reform or something, and asked me to present this on behalf of both of our cabinet councils. We have come to a meeting of the minds, thanks to Mac Baldrige and Doug Riggs from his department, and Doug Ginsburg, who's at the end of the table, the head of the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice, and others, who worked very hard with our cabinet council to put together a consensus position on antitrust reform. And I'll ask Doug to explain it, basically the proposal we have before you today.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President, I know you have a memo from the policy councils, and so I'll be rather brief in going back over the legislative recommendations for reform of the antitrust laws, and ask your approval to pursue them vigorously just as soon as the Congress returns in January. The unifying theme in these proposals is to fully update the antitrust laws for the first time in some decades. First, in order to reflect modern economic conditions, and especially the emergence of global markets in the period since World War II. But secondly, to reflect modern economic thinking. The simple fact is, not surprisingly perhaps, we understand how competitive markets work better now than we did 20 years ago, let alone 50 or 70 years ago when these laws were written. As a result of work in the last 20 years, economic thinking and antitrust thinking have really undergone a revolution. And I think it's fair to say that it's been spurred in large part by the work of some of your appointees to the courts, especially Professors Bork and Winter from Yale, Professors Posner and Easterbrook from Chicago, all of whom were put on the courts of appeals. And the new markets can and often do form competitively. If government regulation doesn't create a barrier to the entry of new firms into those markets, consumers will rarely have reason to fear that they'll be forced to pay monopoly prices. As the Attorney General said in 1981, as Attorney General Meese has reiterated since then, bigness isn't badness. Secondly, our